Disneyland's Snow White attraction takes riders through a montage of scenes that loosely retell the story of the film like a storybook. Well, a terrifying storybook. You as the rider are an observer to the narrative playing out in front of you as you move through the ride, much like an audience member watching a movie on a screen. This wasn't always the case, however. When it opened with Disneyland in 1955, the intention was for riders not to be observers, but to be Snow White herself. Imagineers wanted riders to feel just like how Snow White felt when she was pursued by the evil queen, and thus Snow White didn't appear in the attraction at all. And, well, guests just didn't get it. They expected to see Snow White. They expected to see the story of the movie plainly retold. The idea of casting guests as characters in the story was seen as a mistake, and Snow White was eventually added into the ride. But as it turns out, that unique perspective was really just 70 years ahead of its time. My name is Greg Gerberic, and this is the Queue Line Lectures. Fast Pass, a shorter series about theme park design. Before we go blaming guests in 1955 for not understanding that they were experiencing the attraction of Snow White, it's important to remember that they had little conception for true immersive storytelling. That word immersive can sometimes feel overused, but here I'm using it specifically to mean a ride that asks the audience to exist within the world of the narrative. That definition is closely related to the more widely known idea of the fourth wall, or proscenium. In traditional theater, the proscenium is the imagined plane that separates the audience from the reality occurring on stage, within the three walls of the set, with the name proscenium coming from the arch that encompasses the stage. Most media upholds that imagined proscenium by not interacting with or even acknowledging the audience, but in more recent decades it's become more and more common to see films, TV shows, video games, and experiences that poke holes in, or even downright shatter, the perceived barrier. Theme parks have always muddied the waters around where the proscenium lies. After all, their very design is inviting you into a physical incarnation of a narrative. But I think if you look broadly at the industry, you can see some clear patterns in how parks approach the proscenium has changed over time. When trying to understand how any particular attraction deals with this concept, it's useful to ask what role, if any, do you have in the narrative? Are the characters interacting with you, or do you just watch as they go about their business? A ride like Splash Mountain certainly creates a world that wholly surrounds the rider, but it has a classically strong proscenium, and that riders are only observing the story playing out in front of them. When you ride Splash Mountain, you aren't Br'er Rabbit, you're not another critter character, you're just an audience member, floating by various scenes that don't acknowledge your existence. This strong proscenium was actually the status quo for many Disney attractions that came after the negative reaction to Snow White. While the ghost host on the Haunted Mansion does speak directly to riders, there's no narrative justification for who we are, why we're choosing to visit a haunted mansion, or why this mansion somehow has a cavalcade of buggies running right through it. Pirates of the Caribbean is certainly transporting with its huge dynamic show scenes, but it isn't fully immersive in the sense that riders don't have any role in the fictional world of the attraction. Even Space Mountain and Big Thunder Mountain don't really go out of their way to justify any place riders have in the experience. Are we miners? Astronauts? It doesn't really matter, as the intention is mimicking the sensation of flying through space or being aboard a runaway train, not creating a specific story in which that is occurring. To be clear, having a defined proscenium like that is not a shortcoming. It's a stylistic choice that focuses the experience more on the world or characters being presented. It's a narrative experience being shown to you, but it isn't about you. So, what causes that pendulum to start swinging in the other direction towards fourth wall breaking rides? Well, there are certainly multiple factors like the rise of video games and interactive media, but I'd argue it's mostly spurred by the infusion of more intellectual properties into the parks. In the late 1980s and early 90s, you get a rush of blockbuster movies being adapted to rides like Star Tours, Honey, I Shrunk the Kids, Indiana Jones, oh, and a whole theme park called Universal Studios. With the catchphrase "ride the movies," Universal in this new IP era needed to differentiate the ride experience from the experience of watching the movie, and breaking the proscenium became a crowd-pleasing way to do just that. Guests don't need to see Jaws attack the crew of the Orca again, just like in the film. They want to get attacked by Jaws themselves, and barely lived to tell the tale. Sure, you saw Luke do the Death Star trench run in A New Hope, but you have to come to Disneyland and ride Star Tours so that you can do it yourself. This trend is only intensified in recent years. When making a spiritual successor to Pirates of the Caribbean for Shanghai, the ride storyline was adjusted to recognize riders and give them a place in the story. We're no longer observers here. The pirates are talking directly to us. Where a ride like the Haunted Mansion doesn't have to sweat the exact logic of your ride vehicle, Flight of Passage spends 10 minutes and 2 pre-shows spelling out in great detail the lore and technology of how you and your Link Chair fit into this narrative universe. Even a newer take on a traditional storybook ride, like Under the Sea with the Little Mermaid, needs to wrap the whole story in an immersive package by showing us that this is actually Scuttle retelling the events of the film. Times have changed, and guests just expect to play a larger and larger role in their attractions. Upcoming experiences are only pushing this boundary even further. Disney's Galactic Star Cruiser isn't a Star Wars hotel. It's 3 days of living, eating, sleeping, and playing inside this fictional universe. With experiences like that, the fourth wall is getting so broken, it's harder to imagine putting it back together again. When Universal Studios Japan opened Super Nintendo World earlier this year, they launched an ad campaign with the slogan, "We are Mario." It's a very simple expression, but it promises exactly the experience guests now want from their themed experiences. This isn't a land about getting to see the world of the Mushroom Kingdom. It's about playing around and experiencing it, just like Mario. It's ironic that this ad campaign is selling exactly the vision that Snow White tried and failed to show guests 70 years ago. In 1955, we weren't ready to be the protagonist of a ride, and now that very idea is the whole sales pitch. Themed entertainment is always evolving to wow guests in bigger and bolder ways, but only time will show exactly how the future of parks is shaped by the ambitious failures of today. Thanks for watching.